This is another You, Me, and BTC special. Thanks for tuning in. Today we're speaking with Jeffrey Tucker, one of the most respected voices in the Liberty world. His current project is a new social media network called Liberty.me, which he says is the most elaborate website in existence. He'll tell us all about it and explain why it's so important to our world. If you're interested in joining the community, visit Liberty.me and try it free for 30 days. When you realize that you can't live without it, use the promo code YMB to get $5 off your monthly subscription for life. Of course, it's hard to love Liberty without loving Bitcoin, so Mr. Tucker will tell us what's so great about cryptocurrency as well. And just for kicks, he's going to chat a bit about the Disney movie Frozen. Apparently, he loves to sing Let It Go while he's at the barbershop. Stay tuned for all this and more. Your hosts are Tim Baker, John Stuart, and myself, Daniel Brown. Here we go.
Hey everyone, this is guys from You, Me, and BTC again from the Bitcoin the Beltway conference. I'd like to thank again our sponsors for helping us get here from Monero and API Coin. Right now we're sitting down with Mr. Jeffrey Tucker. Thank you for being here. And I know you're the founder of Liberty.me, and you also involved, I think, are you the founder too of Laissez-Faire Books?
Well, I kind of revived Laissez-Faire Books a couple of years ago when I went to work for them. It was actually November, I think, 2011. I went to work for Laissez-Faire and started a subscription-based model to try to bring the company back, and now it's back. I was looking at the traffic rating this morning. It's actually through the roof. It's really impressive. But about this time last year, I started getting this idea for having a kind of a cloud-based crowdsourcing of ideas for Liberty. It was inspired very much by Bitcoin. You know, Bitcoin's a kind of amazing technology that sort of emerged out of the blue to make our lives much freer. It holds out a huge promise for reinventing the world. And I learned from that something very important about human liberty. It's not something that is ever granted by government. It's something that's built by individuals. So if that's true, we need to get to work doing that. So I wanted to build a kind of a space in the sky, which is our, you know, in the cloud, which is our new frontier, for people to kind of think about and talk about issues of human liberty, actionable ideas that we can do in our own lives to make the world a freer place without having to go to politicians and beg them for our rights. That's a different way of conceiving of the project. And so far, we've only been open 6 weeks. It's been doing very well. I'm very pleased. Anybody can go subscribe at liberty.me, and there's no ads, there's no trolls, there's no flame wars. It's just people being cool and trying to figure out how to overcome the great problem of our time, which is despotism.
This question is really simple, and it's almost redundant as a Bitcoin podcast. It's almost like, why are you even asking this question? But if there's one person that I want to hear answer this question, it's you. Why do you like Bitcoin?
To me, Bitcoin restores private property to the institution of money. After 100 years of nationalization and hundreds of years of government control, it's actually a bottom-up solution that restores money as property that you and I can own and trade individually. In so many ways, Bitcoin is kind of old-fashioned. It's almost like a monetary system from the Middle Ages where money really was stuff that you held. You know, it was like really stuff you really owned and traded. So it was sound and solid. But it's way better than that because the way you trade it is not contingent in any way on geography. So you can trade it with any other person in the world without the intervention of a third party. That's amazing. I mean, it potentially can shut down or make an end run around the world financial cartel, which has been, you know, sort of the great evil of the 20th century that led to so many wars and Leviathan control and inflation and financial upheavals. It's all a consequence of government nationalization of money. So yeah, Bitcoin holds out the possibility that we can get rid of that. And I'm not sure that's why it was invented. Maybe it was. But really, Bitcoin is so technologically superior to all the monies we use that it's necessarily going to replace national monies. It's just going to be a matter of time, really.
Can you tell us really what changed your mind about Bitcoin? I think I've heard you say in the past about something about finding out about the cap at 21 million.
Yeah, I was a skeptic about Bitcoin because I didn't really understand it for a long time. I mean, it's a little bit tricky. You have to know things like about cryptography and distributed networks, open source software development, and monetary theory. There's a lot to know to really understand Bitcoin. And these days, we all do want to understand it, the same since everybody wanted to understand what the heck electricity was and light, indoor lighting was in the 1880s. You know, I mean, it's a little mystifying before you try something, you want to really sort of understand it. So we want to understand it. It took me a while to figure it out. And it was, yeah, the fact that, so I doubted that you could ever have an internet-based money because the internet specializes in copying, right? So I thought, well, you can't have a money that's on the internet because it can be infinitely copied. Same as the Federal Reserve note, right? So I thought, well, this will never work. But then I saw that it was built into the protocol, that there's a scarcity built into it. And yeah, there's a cap on the number of Bitcoins. And most importantly, the rate of monetary creation is fixed and embedded in the protocol. It's expected. It's not like the Federal Reserve, where one day they're creating, you know, a trillion notes, you know, and you had no clue that was happening, and everything's kind of behind closed doors. Everything's really open, and so there's a systematic rate of money creation within the Bitcoin world, and it caps at the end. And to me, that was very impressive that you could build that into a protocol. In other words, taking this sort of infinitely non-scarce world of the internet and sort of hacking it in a way that created a scarce good on the internet was, to me, just an unbelievably brilliant solution. And then, of course, I discovered there's other things that are brilliant about Bitcoin. The blockchain technology, you know, just blows me away. The distributed network and the use of cryptography to exchange only the information that needs to be exchanged and no other kind of information that's not necessary to exchange. So that was amazing. I had to learn all about cryptography. But so the whole process of discovering why Bitcoin was amazing took me, I guess, in total of about 6 weeks of pretty hard labor. But then once you discover it, I mean, you just fall in love and you realize why it's so incredible. I think it's more important than internal combustion or the metallurgical advances that led to steel and allowed for the building of bridges and skyscrapers or railroad systems or really anything else. This is the most important technological innovation in hundreds of years, really.
Yeah, I think that's just really cool. We've done some episodes on like intellectual property and stuff like that, and talking about copyrights. And it's like, it was hard for us to understand too. Like, how can you have something on the internet that can't be copied? But that's how it works. And it's really awesome. Also, I just want to say, I think I heard that story about you changing your mind and thinking through things. I think I heard that on Glenn Beck, and I thought that was cool. Just want to say thanks for doing that. That was cool to see you on there and talking to him and stuff like that. I guess I want to drop back a little bit to liberty.me now real quick. Can you just tell us what all you can do there, what it's like, and what if you have any plans for updates, cool things you're doing in the future?
Well, as far as I know, it's actually the most elaborate website that exists in the whole World Wide Web right now. I mean, we have fully 25 different pieces of widgetry that are operating under one authentication stream. You know, it's incredible. So like right now you can go and we have all sorts of guides to things like schooling or migration or grocery shopping or Bitcoin or, you know, whatever the thing is that you can do to kind of get around the central plans. Those are kind of serve as the core of the site. But then we have about 150 books you can download instantly for free. All of them are especially customized. I've written introductions to a lot of them. These are sort of liberty classics. We have ongoing discussions in the discussion forums about the books. We have nightly classes that are live, that are running on a platform that is HTML5, so there's nothing to download. You can just go to a URL and go to class. And we've had classes on firearms training, on business cycle theory, on psychology, on, you know, how to work in Brazil and teach English. I mean, you name it. Every night there's some different class going on, and we have ongoing 24/7 chat, live chat that you can engage with other users. We have full Facebook functionality. The private messaging, everything is 100% encrypted. So yeah, this was an expensive and elaborate platform to develop. And we have a subscription-based model, so you're paying, you know, $9 a month or something like that. And people said that it would never work because people aren't willing to pay. My view was, like, if I can deliver enough value, people will be willing to pay for it and to get away from the flame wars and all that stuff that exists on the public internet. And so far, we're doing very, very well. We've only been open 6 weeks. It's a really happy community. And I think one of the reasons it's a happy community is that everybody there has skin in the game. So everybody's let go of a little bit of their own personal property in order to be invested in this community. But I forgot to mention, the reason I started the site is that you can have your own publishing space. So if you're a subscriber, then you can develop your own website, and it's a full WordPress installation that's turnkey solution for you. So you can publish all your thoughts and get your thoughts in front of the community. And that's a new technology. You could do it 5 years ago, but it was almost unaffordable. Now, with virtualization having made such advances, you can do this. I like to think of it as like putting down a plot of land. Like if you think about the Dakotas, say in the 1840s or something like that, you know, people would move there and kind of move in and have their little plot of land and start a new life for themselves. That's sort of what I think of as going on at liberty.me. Right now we're homesteading real estate, and you can get your own URL, and all systems auto, very automatic. So these subdomains are created, you know, instantly and repeatedly, you know, all the time. And so people have a place to kind of live and then to show off their writings to their friends. And it's all about intellectual growth and personal growth, really. That's the goal. Like I said before, I've pretty much lost all hope for the political process. I don't think that that's the way we're going to change the world. I think we're going to change the world from the inside out, starting with our own lives and the choices that we make. And then eventually we're going to obsolete the state. I think that's what's going to happen. And I just wanted to be part of the solution. Something realistic, something that was workable, and something that was really practical.
Yeah, we were just talking with Paige from MadeSafe and the guys from Fiva Wallet earlier about how this whole conference has been really grassroots, and it's had a focus on kind of big conceptual ideas and stuff like that. And we all love it for that reason. I guess I'm just wondering, what have you enjoyed most about the conference so far?
Well, at this point, you know, this is, I guess, my fifth big Bitcoin conference. So it's really fun now because I get to see a lot of old friends. But you see a kind of a migration of opinion a little bit at each conference. In the early days, all we did was talk about Bitcoin. Now we're talking about all these Bitcoin 2.0 solutions and the model of Bitcoin, which is really about decentralization, as you say, and about peer-to-peer technologies. And we're beginning to gradually realize that the Bitcoin revolution is about a lot more than a payment system or about a lot more than money. It's really about human freedom. And it's about our own independence and our right to create the world we want for ourselves in the future. So things like MadeSafe, you know, it's just amazing. And bit messaging and smart contracting and all these things. I mean, in the early days, I realized that Bitcoin held out the promise of replacing the world's national monies, which is like an ominous, outrageous thing to imagine. But now I've begun to realize that it actually holds out the possibility of eliminating all third-party relationships, particularly those with governments. So through the blockchain technology, we can actually create a world that is a polycentric legal order that's entirely run on the principles of voluntarism. So it's all part of basically getting rid of the great mistake of the last century, which was the Leviathan state. So that's really what's at stake. I think the future of civilization is at stake, really. And part of me feels bad for people who have not been curious about Bitcoin. Because they don't know what they're missing. I mean, if you look into it, you realize there's so much reason for hope in our time. We're so fortunate to live now as opposed to, say, 50 years ago. There seemed to be very little hope for human freedom 50 years ago. Now, with the blockchain and cryptography and open source networking and distributed networks and all these things, we have these tools to really remake the world. And governments of the world just can't possibly keep up under these circumstances. I mean, they're so anachronistic compared to what we're developing now. It's beautiful to be part of it.
Yeah, it is amazing, and that we love all of that. So one kind of interesting thing I wanted to bring up, I follow you on Twitter, and I noticed a while ago you talked about Frozen all the time in the song Let It Go.
That's going on in my head right now, actually.
Can you tell us what it is about that, why you like that?
Oh, I like that song for the same reason everybody else likes that song. You know, it's just the sense of just letting go of the past and making the decisive decision to march into the future with a determination to succeed, regardless of what the community thinks, regardless of what everybody expects of you. And so I really think that's a beautiful hymn of human liberation. I love that movie so much. You know, I didn't expect much of it, you know, and even from the first frames, it was just amazing. And I think the soundtrack is just glorious. I haven't seen the new Disney film, but I think Frozen is the best of all the ones I've ever seen. Yeah. You know, you're right. I couldn't shut up about it. You know, I got really excited about it. Even now, I enjoy just sort of singing it like at airports or at the barbershop or whatever, and seeing who can join in, you know, and it's really fun. It's kind of become a kind of an international anthem of sorts, a real tribute to human liberation. My friend Stefan Molyneux, I don't know if you know him, wrote a gigantic attack in the film. And I read it, and I didn't really, I don't know, I think sometimes he overthinks things in a way. It's just a really fun movie about, you know, struggling your way through life and having to stake your claim in this world. And I think Let It Go sort of summarizes it all, you know. Maybe my thoughts should be more higher level, but that's the whole thing. I always enjoy kids' movies so much. Oftentimes more than so-called adult fare, because they're bigger themes that are always connected to human liberation. I think there's something about a child that just really wants to grow up and be free, you know? And so almost all those movies, you know, are about this great struggle of getting away from authority and becoming responsible and staking your own claim to this world and making your own choices. That's what kids want to do. And somehow we grow up and we forget that dream. So animated films just sort of recapture that and always inspires me.
So one thing we do with pretty much all of our guests, as long as we can remember, is ask you for kind of like a unique personal story, I guess specifically about Bitcoin or crypto stuff in general, just maybe something funny, maybe you got scammed once or something, or you met somebody awesome, just any kind of unique personal story.
Yeah, well, you know, my personal experience with Bitcoin was my first time expending it, because it's one thing to own it. That was exciting enough, but then to actually use it, you know, changes everything. And so my first purchase with Bitcoin was a pair of crimping pliers that I bought from the Bitcoin store. This is back before you could really buy air tickets or you couldn't use overstock.com or anything like that. And yeah, I remember my first experience with it and realizing, I mean, it was like a revelation, because I realized I had seen the future, you know, I just really experienced it. And I just got up from the table and just danced around the kitchen for a while, because I realized what was coming for the very first time. And it completed the picture for me. To acquire it is amazing. To spend it, wow, that was it. You know, that was it. And ever since then, I've been using Bitcoin all the time. I did have one time, I lost 10 Bitcoin one time. And it was because I was multitasking, just going too quickly. And I clicked the wrong button, sent to the wrong address, and it's gone. Which is kind of interesting. I mean, I was extremely annoyed and, you know, like all the way, anybody that happens to you, spend several days, you know, fretting about it and you don't know what happened. And I still am not entirely sure what happened. I'm sure it was user error of some sort. But I do like the fact that within the Bitcoin world, there's no chargebacks. It's a proof that it's real property. I mean, once it's gone out of your hands, it's really gone out of your hands. You know, you can maybe send a fraction of a Bitcoin to the address you sent it before with a attached note, please give me my Bitcoin back. You know, in that way, it's really very much like the physical world. You know, if I give somebody $5, they've got that $5 now, you know, and if I want it back, I'm going to have to like persuade them or beat them up or something. It's that way in the Bitcoin world, you know, and it's hard to get used to. Our user interfaces, to my mind, are not quite where they need to be. I mean, it's not quite simple enough for regular people. It's still prone to error. We've got a lot of protections built into them. Some of them are not good, actually. Like two-factor authentication, you know, I understand why people use it, but I've been on airplanes before flying through the air using the internet and wanting to send Bitcoin and then having my account come back and say, well, you need to check the code that we've sent you via SMS. Well, you're in the middle of the air flying around. You can't get an SMS that way. So it kind of subverts. So suddenly you're stopped, you know. So there's little issues like that that we're going to have to overcome. But look, I mean, I was there for the whole development of email from the early days all the way through. And I remember there were times when email threatened to be taken over by spam. You know, there are all kinds of problems. The addresses were ugly in the early days. You couldn't have your name like Tucker @. You know, it was more like 0672, you know, like this. There were a lot of problems with email. And a lot of skeptics who thought that email was just kind of stupid, because why not just send whatever you need to send through a modem or send it through the mail. There's always people out there willing to debunk a technology. And one of the reasons is that technology, as it emerges in the world, is imperfect. And people are really quick to seize on the imperfections. And you have to have a vision to understand that markets are a process and they're gradually unfolding. As imperfect as they are, there's always an incentive to fix them up. And sometimes it takes a very long time. I think that's what we're going through right now in the Bitcoin world. So I appreciate those people who love Bitcoin now, because it is a kind of slightly tricky to understand. Like I say, I compare it to electricity in the 1880s. You know, there were early adopters, and some people said, we don't need that stuff. That doesn't do any good. People said the same thing about internal combustion engines. We don't need this. Our current system works just fine. People say that all the time about Bitcoin, you know? So we're going through the exact same thing we've gone through every other technological revolution. I mean, even in the age of steel, people really debunked steel. They said that it was not as hard as iron, that it doesn't serve any purpose, it's too expensive to make. There's no really great advantage to it. And the iron industry was a big advocate of iron. And they used to hold public contests between iron and steel, you know, which one was better. The iron industry just absolutely dedicated to iron. And that's what they believed in. So we're going through the same thing now with Bitcoin and national monies. Everybody will tell you, well, I don't need Bitcoin. My money works just fine. Well, give it time. You'll discover. You'll figure it out. It's just going to take some time.
Yeah, so if anybody randomly got 10 Bitcoins, Jeffrey Tucker wants them back. All right. Do you have anything you want to plug? Any Twitter handles or places to check you out?
Yeah, so you can go to liberty.me and join the community. I would love it if you did. We'll welcome you. Send me a chat message and I'll let you in, and you'll be part of a wonderful community. You can follow me on Twitter, of course. I've got an official page on Facebook. I've got a personal page on Facebook. All that kind of stuff. You're welcome to send me an email anytime. But anyway, thanks for listening. Thanks for having me on your show. I appreciate it.
No, thank you. That was Jeffrey Tucker from liberty.me. Thanks. Thanks for listening to another special You, Me, and BTC interview. Remember that 75% of the tips for this and all of our other Bitcoin in the Beltway interviews will go directly to Sean's Outpost. We want to thank our generous sponsors once again, API Coin and Monero. Visit apicoin.io to learn more about the new Bitcoin API. And visit Monero.cc to learn about the new, truly anonymous cryptocurrency. Don't forget to check out Liberty.me. Remember, you can use the promo code YMB to get $5 off every month for life. All of the music in today's show, except for that frozen part, was from John Stuart. We'll see you next time.
To see what I can do to test the limits and break through. No light, no road, no rules for me. I'm free. Let it go, let it go. I am one with the wind and sky. Let it go, let it go. You'll never see me cry. Bothered me anyway.